Hare Krishna. Grateful to be here amongst all of you today. And thank you. I'll speak today on how Sanjaya's devotional and grateful heart is revealed towards the end of the Bhagavad Gita. So Sanjaya speaks periodically throughout the Gita. Actually, at one level, the whole Gita, as we have got it, is what Sanjaya has spoken. Sanjaya is repeating to Dhritarashtra what Krishna has spoken. But there are specific passages within the Gita which Sanjaya himself speaks. So he speaks in the first chapter, in the second chapter, in the 11th chapter, in the 18th chapter. But the maximum he speaks is in the 18th chapter. And the generally, whenever a person speaks, people's words are like windows to their heart. What they speak reveals what they think and who they are. So Sanjaya has been, we could say in today's world, like the secretary of Dhritarashtra. And Dhritarashtra had his advisors. An advisor of his own age and his generation was Vidur. But Vidur goes to the forest when Duryodhan insults him unbearably. And thereafter, Sanjay slowly starts taking the role of a friend as well as an advisor. Although Sanjay is a Suta and Dhritarashtra is a Kshatriya and a king. So technically the hierarchy is Sanjay is much lower, but still because they have had a long relationship, Sanjay advises. And Sanjay also reveals to us how we can have a grateful and a joyful heart. So let's look at the last five verses which Sanjay speaks. You can go to 18.74. So we'll look from 18.74 to 78. And thereby we will understand what is the understanding of Sanjaya and how a grateful heart, a heart that is grateful for what one has got, is a joyful heart. So we could say the Bhagavad Gita ends at various places. The Bhagavad Gita at one level ends in the 10th chapter when Krishna spoke the Chatushloki. At another level, after that Arjuna asks many questions and that's how the Bhagavad Gita goes on. At another level, the Bhagavad Gita ends in 18.66, which Ramanujacharya says the Charam Shloka, Sarva Dharmaan Parityajya Mam Ekam Sharanam Raja. Thereafter, what comes is the Phala Shruti, the fruit of hearing. So then Krishna describes that those who hear, those who share the message of the Gita, they are glorious. Those who hear the message of the Gita, they are also glorious. Those who study are also glorious. And then finally, in 18.72, Krishna asks Arjuna, have you understood clearly? Have you heard clearly? Have you understood clearly? And then Arjuna replies in 18.73, yes, my illusion is dispelled. And there, with that background, now Sanjaya is speaking these five verses. So let's recite 18.74. Sanjaya Uvacha. Ityaham Vasudevasya. Ityaham Vasudevasya. Parthasya cha mahatmanaha, parthasya cha mahatmanaha, samvadam imam ashrausham, imam ashrausham, adbhutam romaharshanam. So, here Sanjay is summarizing what he has heard and he is also indirectly instructing Dhritarashtra. So, ityaham, in this way, Vasudevasya, Parthasya, these two people, Vasudev and Partha. So, in the Mahabharat, Krishna is frequently referred to by the name Vasudev. That is a more formal name. He is a prominent descendant, prominent son of Vasudev, is called Vasudev. And Partha is the son of Pritha, Kunti. So, these two people, their conversation I have heard. Now, why does he use the word specifically Vasudevasya and Parthasya? That Vasudev and Partha and Pritha are of the same generation as Dhritarashtra. So these are two people who have descended from that generation, but the indirect indication is that they have become so wise. O Dhritarashtra, you have remained unenlightened. Ityaham Vasudevasya Parthasya cha Mahatmanaha. Mahatmanaha. They are both great souls. Now, in Sanskrit, as in any other language, the words have literal meanings and words have denotations and they have connotations. Denotation means what they literally mean. So, Mahatma, Atma is the soul. Mahatma is the great soul. So now, at one level we can say Krishna is surely the great soul. Because Krishna is the greatest being, he is infinite. He is omnipotent, omnipresent, omniscient. So he is definitely Mahatma. Now how is Arjuna a Mahatma? Arjuna, and the Bhagavad Gita has earlier described how the soul is immeasurably small, aprameya. It's immeasurable, but immeasurable not in the sense of immeasurably large, but immeasurable in the terms of immeasurably small. So the Acharyas explain that the Atma which is Anu, which is tiny, which is atomic, which is fragmental, when the Anu Atma becomes devoted to the Mahatma, then that devotion also makes the Anu Atma the Mahatma. The soul will, in size always remains small. So the word Mahatma literally in terms of denotation refers to Krishna. But in terms of significance, signification, it also refers to Arjuna. That Arjuna has become a great soul because he is totally surrendered to Krishna. In fact, Krishna has said earlier in the Bhagavad Gita, he has defined who is a Mahatma. In 9.13 he said, Mahatmanastu mam partha daivem prakritim ashritah bhajanti ananya manaso jnatva bhutadim avyayam. He says, those people are Mahatmas who devote themselves wholeheartedly to Krishna, having no other concerns. And because in the previous verse only Arjuna has declared that I understand that you are my Lord, nashto moha smriti labdha tat prasadan mayachuta sthito smigata sandeha karishye vachinam tava. I will do your will. So by such surrender to Krishna, Arjuna has become a Mahatma. In the Christian tradition, Jesus is considered to be having a great level of love of God, and he is to give up his life for God. So there, just before the day he is crucified, the previous night, he foresees what is going to happen. And there he expresses his surrender in an exalted way. He says that, O Father, let thy will be done, not mine. So now, this is one way of surrendering. Something is going to happen, I accept it. Let thy will be done, not mine. However, Arjun expresses surrender in another way. Not just let your will happen and I'll accept it, O Lord, but I will become an instrument for your will. So let thy will be done is one way of surrender. Another way of surrender is, I will do your will. So broadly speaking in our life, we can say that we can have two different visions of devotion. One is devotion means dependence on Krishna. Krishna, you are my Lord, I am your servant, I depend on you. And this is the mood in which Draupadi surrenders to Krishna. That she says, Krishna, I am helpless, you please help me. She raises her hands in helpless dependence. And that is one way of surrender. So, there is another way of surrender, which is what Arjuna does. Krishna tells Arjuna in the Bhagavad Gita that surrender to me. Sarvadharman pratyamamekam sharanam raja. And that's 18.66. 7 verses later when Arjuna says, Karishyeva chinam tava, I'll do your will. That means he's surrendering to Krishna. But then Arjuna's surrender, how is it? He actually picks up his bow in readiness to fight. So Arjuna's surrender is not by raising hands in dependence. In Arjuna's surrender is by raising his bow in readiness to fight. So devotion can be expressed by dependence on Krishna, and devotion can also be expressed by diligence for Krishna. Diligence for Krishna means when we have something important to do, in the service of Krishna, then we have to wholeheartedly surrender to him by being diligent in our service to him. Now, 20 years ago when I first started giving talks, so I was given a senior devotee gave me a list of 10 guidelines about how to speak in public for Krishna. So there were various guidelines. The last point was depend on Krishna, but in bracket, but only after you have prepared. So even when we have to speak about Krishna, we have to prepare for it. So if somebody comes without preparation and starts speaking, say, I am dependent on Krishna. You are not dependent on Krishna, you are simply being irresponsible over there. So there are two aspects to surrender. There is dependence on Krishna and there is diligence for Krishna. And both of these come together by understanding that there are in our life, there are some things in our control and some things which are not in our control. For the things that are not in our control, we need to have dependence on Krishna. Krishna, accept your will. For the things that are in our control, we need diligence for Krishna. And in that way, we bring both together. So, Arjun is also exhibiting dependence on Krishna because he is worried. What about my loved ones? They are there on the war field, they may die. But Krishna has assured him that Krishna, the Gita has assured him that Krishna is the well-wisher of everyone. And because he is the well-wisher of everyone, so whatever will happen to those on the opposite side, they will be taken care of by Krishna. Generally, when we worry, when do we worry usually? It is when we don't have anything tangible to do. When we are busy doing something, we don't have time to worry. But when we are idle, relaxing, at that time our mind starts worrying. What if this goes wrong? What if that goes wrong? What if that goes wrong? It said that during our leisure time, our mind works overtime. Starts worrying, what about this, what about that, what about that. So actually, now if whenever we started feeling worried, instead of worrying, we started praying to Krishna. If we prayed to Krishna as much as we worried, we would worry a lot less. Because we worry about the things that are not in our control. What if this goes wrong? What if that goes wrong? What if that goes wrong? But if we understand that what is not in my control is in Krishna's control. And if I pray to Krishna, if I connect with Krishna, if I surrender to Krishna, then Krishna will take care of things. So that is the mood. So Arjun is at one level picking up the bow in readiness to fight, to do his part. But for what is not in his control, he is depending on Krishna. And so thus, because he has surrendered to Krishna, therefore he has also become a Mahatma. And in that way, these two Mahatmas are having a conversation. Samvadam imam ashrausham. So Sanjay is saying, I have heard this conversation among these two people. And what is the nature of this kind of conversation? Adbhutam romaharshanam. It is adbhuta. It is extraordinary. It is wondrous. It is thrilling. Romaharshanam. It is causing my hair to stand up. Talk about my hair getting standing up, my ear got pulled down. So Roma Harshanam. Now this point about Roma Harshanam, about Arjun Sanjay being thrilled, will be elaborated further. But here Sanjay is revealing an awareness that the conversation that happened was not an ordinary conversation, but something very special happened. Many times in history, if something like historic is happening, say America gained independence, India gained independence, or there are, if you look at history, there are historical events that have happened. But when those historical events are happening, many people at that time are not even aware of what is happening. Something very important will be happening right in front of us, but we may not even be aware of it. So, it's that there are three kind of people. Some people make things happen. Some people watch things happen. And some people wonder what happened. So we could say these three are categories of sattva, rajas and tamas. People in sattva think, plan and make things happen. People in rajas just run around do this, do that. But they do one thing and another, ten things go wrong. And they try to fix those 10 things and 100 things go wrong. What's happening? They want, some people watch things happen. Oh, this is happening, this is happening, this is happening. And some people wonder what happened. They're just so lost in their own world. So, Sanjay is not just repeating the conversation that has happened between Krishna and Arjuna. He's also appreciating the conversation. This is a very special conversation. It's between great souls and it is wondrous and it is thrilling. So in this verse, he appreciates the conversants and the conversation. That it is actually a conversation between great souls and it is a great conversation. So, any questions or comments till this point? So we are discussing five verses, so we will divide the class into five parts. But if anyone has any questions, can let me know. Humble obeisance, Pyare Mohanru. So, any questions or comments till now?
Okay.
Yeah. So, we are. Yes, Prabhu. We are just discussing the Sanjay's words in the Bhagavad Gita. So, I talked about how Sanjay appreciated that this is a great conversation between great souls. So, that is the first verse we discussed. Let's go to 70. There's no comment. Let's go to 75 then. So, if we look at this conversation, I have analyzed this into three parts. There is the conversation itself, that is mentioned in the first. And then, he got to hear the conversation because of some arrangement. So suppose we get to do something very special, you know, if we get to go to some special program, if we get to do something very special, we appreciate that it is special. But then we also appreciate who helped us to get there. Maybe this person invited me, this person arranged for me to come there. So now, when he's appreciating the conversation, he appreciates the one by whose grace he was able to hear this conversation. So that's 18.75. Vyasa prasada shrutvan. Vyasa prasada shrutvan. Etad guhyam aham param.
Etad guhyam aham param.
Yogam Yogeshwarat Krishnat Sakshat Kathayatah Swayam. So Vyasa Prasadat Shutvan. How am I able to hear this? It is because of Vyasa. It is Vyasa who gave me the mercy. Now before the Kurukshetra war, Vyasadev came to meet Dhritarashtra. At one level, Vyasadev is the father of Dhritarashtra. Vyasadev was the person, because Ambika and Ambalika, both of them, their husband passed away without they having any progeny and the dynasty was to be continued. So they resorted to a ritual practice called Niyoga. Niyoga means some relative impregnates the women so that the dynasty can be continued. And they have contact only for that purpose and nothing else. So, that is a tradition which was there in the past in India as well as elsewhere. So, technically, the man who's impregnated the woman, the man has no claim over the child. That woman is still the wife of that husband. The Pandavas were also, Kunti got them from the gods. But the Pandavas are not primarily defined as the sons of Indra or any of them, Ashwini Kumaras. They're defined as the sons of Pandu. Similarly, the Dhritarashtra is not primarily known as the son of Vyasa. But still, there is natural affection. So when Indra, he gets Arjun to come to heaven, and Indra is so pleased to see his son. Mahada Sanardham. Indra actually asks Arjun to sit on his throne with him. Like father wants whatever he has, the best of it for his son to have. So Vyas has natural concern for Dhritarashtra. And because of that concern, he repeatedly comes and tries to give good advice to Dhritarashtra. And finally, So Vyas tries to tell Dhritarashtra, stop your son from this suicidal war. And when Dhritarashtra does not listen to him, then finally Vyas says to him, Dhritarashtra, see, sometimes when we are doing any service, we want to get the full success. If you want to get the full success, then we at least want to get partial success. If you don't, can't get partial success, then at the very least we want to cut our losses. That I should not lose too much. So Vyasadeva wants to avoid the war and instruct Dhritarashtra and Duryodhan both. But Duryodhan is not ready to listen. He's adamant. So then the war is going to be inevitable and Duryodhan is going to perish. Then he thinks, at least let Dhritarashtra be enlightened. Let Dhritarashtra see the war. So the idea is that if Dhritarashtra sees the war, he will see the extraordinary power of Krishna as is manifested directly and indirectly through the activities of the Pandavas indirectly and through Krishna's intervention to protect the Pandavas. So that by seeing this, by seeing both the destruction of his own sons and by seeing the power of Krishna, maybe Dhritarashtra's heart will change. And thus, he offers Dhritarashtra vision. Sometimes, seeing the truth unvarnished, not covered, is helpful to force us to see the reality. I was in Kannada, and there, in one of the colleges in Calgary, the professor there had invited me to speak on, there's a college professor, they were studying Hinduism, and they were studying death in various religions. So he asked me, what is the significance of death and everything, that I was to give a talk on that. So one student there asked this question, he said, this burning of the body, it's such a ghastly thing. You know, why do Hindus do this? That, and it's nowadays there is electric crematorium where we just put the body in and then the body gets incinerated in one moment. But traditionally cremation was not like that. People assemble around the body and they see the body burning. So it's such a ghastly thing, you see. You know, to first of all set fire to the body of our loved one, that itself is brutal, and then to watch it all, it's even more brutal. So why do such a thing like this? So I explained that 3 points I said. First is that actually we cannot see any culture from, if we see it from our lens, we will never understand it. So our lens is that we think the person to be the body. And from that perspective, burning the body can seem very brutal. But if we understand that the Gita says that the person is the soul. And when the body is burnt, then the soul, even after the soul dies, the soul is still attached to the body. The soul may still want to come back into the body. But if the body is burned and the soul realizes there is no chance for me to come back in, and therefore the soul becomes ready to move on. So in that sense, burning the body is a graphic destruction of the body that helps the soul to have closure. Now this chapter of my spiritual journey is over. Now let me move on. And closure is very important for the soul. Now, and for the viewers, it may appear ghastly, but for the viewers, when they see it, then they are reminded of the ghastliness of death. They are reminded of how the body which we are so attached to is going to perish. And that creates sobriety. That creates a kind of contemplation on what is really matters, what really lasts. So just as there is a effect of visually seeing something dear destroyed that produces detachment within us. Similarly, Vyasa's hope is that if Dhritarashtra sees his own sons dying, then that will create detachment within him. Dhritarashtra was extremely attached to his son. So therefore, Dhritarashtra was offered by Vyas eyes to see the war. Now, Dhritarashtra is a very conflicted character. At one level, he knows that Krishna's power cannot be resisted. So he is fearing the inevitable and desiring the impossible. The inevitable is his sons are going to die. He's dreading that. He's dreading the inevitable and he's desiring the impossible. That maybe on my side there are Bhishma, there are Drona, my son has got actually almost double the forces which they have got. 11 Akshahunis as compared to the 7. So maybe that my sons will win. So he, because he dreads the thought that his sons may die, so he says that I don't want eyes. But he still has that hope that maybe we will win. So he wants to have the news of what is going to happen. Just like say, if there's a sport which is very common, say if there's a cricket match going on, and if say our team, if say there's an India-Pakistan cricket match, India-Australia cricket match, and India is more or less in losing position. So then many people start, if they are in the stadium, they start walking out of the stadium. If they are watching TV, they just turn off their TV. But after they turn off their TV, maybe after a few minutes they turn it on and see, has anything happened? Has any player playing in a miraculous way and that somehow we will win? So there's the little hope that is there at the background. So like that, at one level, although Dhritarashtra knew that his sons were going to die, he still had some hope. Maybe they will live. So that's how he said, let Sanjay become my eyes. Let Sanjay get the eyes and let him report what is happening to me. So then Vyasa blessed Sanjay with the eyes. So in a sense, he was the incidental beneficiary. He is the incidental beneficiary, but Sanjay is grateful for what he has got. Even if it is incidental, he has got it, he has got it. He has got something very precious. And he appreciates it. Sometimes, you know, if there is a property to be inherited, and then sometimes it happens that there is no direct inheritor. And then you go to a cousin, one relative, one family away, second family away, third family away. Sometimes like fourth, fifth family, you get an inheritance. Now when somebody gets a free inheritance, you know, okay, how I got it is not as important as I got it. So similarly, Vyasa is grateful, I got this. So Vyasa Prasada Shrutvan, by Vyasa's mercy, I got to hear this. Etad Guhyam Ahamparam. This is very confidential. This is very rare knowledge. The knowledge of Dharma was well known in the Vedic tradition. But the knowledge of Bhakti, of Parabhakti, of devotion to Krishna in a mode of selflessness, that was not so well known even at that times. The general options which Arjuna had was action or renunciation. So Krishna told him that through devotion you can have renunciation in action. You can act, but you can act in a mood of renunciation. And this knowledge was very rare. So etad guhyam aham param. And not only is the knowledge special, but I've heard this knowledge from whom? From a very special source. Yogeshwara, yogam. This is the knowledge of yoga. And I've heard it from Yogeshwarat. That Lord who is the Yogeshwar. He is the Lord of all mystic powers. And this word Yogeshwar is used in the Bhagavad Gita only once before. And that is in the 11th chapter. When Mahayogeshwaro Hari Darshayamas Bhutaya, that when Krishna showed the Vishwarupa to Arjuna, at that time Sanjay uses the word, this Krishna is Yogeshwar, he can exhibit extraordinary vision. And that same name he is using over here. Krishna is no ordinary person, he is Yogeshwar, he is God, not just claiming to be God, he is demonstrating that he is God. Sakshat Kathayatah Swayam. He himself has spoken this. So only not only the knowledge spoke special, but the knowledge spoken by that same person. And thus, he's again appreciating the special gift that he has got. That I got special knowledge, I got this from a special source. And by this, now, once we appreciate how special something is, then it also has special effect on us. Suppose sometimes, you know, we get some very delicious food to eat. But Now we are busy, maybe talking on phone, working on the computer, and then we just pick up the food and gobble it. And then sometimes we may eat a very delicious food item and we may not taste it at all, because we are so caught in doing other things. If we come to know this is a very special food item, you know, it is a people, somebody spend hours cooking it, and it is there only if we hear there's some special item which is only maybe 10 people in the world know how to cook it, and we have been given that item. Oh really? Then we will savor it. We'll savor it and then we will relish it also. So only when we appreciate what we have been given, then it has a desired effect on it. So on us. So what the desired effect is, how this awareness of this knowledge accepts, influences Sanjay, that will be described in the next two verses. So any questions or comments till now? Yes, Prabhu. Thank you. Yeah.
Okay. And he cares, of course, for his son. He's so happy to see him. And now his son is involved in like this big war, and Indra is so powerful as a thunderbolt. Why doesn't he help his son?
Okay, good question. Thank you, Ru. So, Indra is so powerful. Why does Indra not help his son? Actually, the Mahabharata describes how the normal hierarchy is inverted with the case of devotion. It's Indra is very powerful, but the Mahabharata describes how Arjun actually is more powerful than Indra. That's why when Arjun goes to the heavens, at that time there are certain demons called Nivat Kavachas. And those demons even Indra has not been able to defeat. And then Indra sends Arjun with his own chariot and his own charioteer, and he defeats those demons. And then Indra tells, you have become greater than me also, I'm proud of you. So of course, Arjun is always respectful to Indra because he's a devata and Arjun is a manava, Arjun is a human being. But along with that, Indra does want to help Arjun. So what Indra does is, he knows Arjun's main rival is Karna. So then he comes in the garb of a Brahmin to ask charity from Karna. And then he asks Karna for his kavach and kundala, for his earrings and his armor, which he had been born with naturally. So, of course, he's a devata, so he cannot ask something from a human being without giving something. So he asks for that kavach, and then Karna asks for the Shakti Astra, for the very powerful weapon of Krishna, of Indra, by which he plans to kill Arjun. So Indra does in his own way try to help Arjun, but in this particular situation, actually the Arjun is more powerful than Indra also. Thank you. Yeah. So let's move on to the last three verses now. 76 and 77 are similar, but a slight difference in stress, in the emphasis. So Sanjay is seeing that Dhritarashtra is still unfazed. Dhritarashtra, although despite hearing this conversation, nothing much, no transformation has happened in him. So then he's trying to tell that Rajan Samsmritya Samsmritya Samvadamimam Adbhutam Keshavarjunayo Punyam Rishyami cha muhurmuhu. So he's telling Rajan Samsmritya Samsmritya. I've heard this conversation, I'm remembering it again and again and again. It's just coming back again and again in my mind. Samvadamim Adbhutam. It's such an amazing conversation. And Keshavarjunayo Punyam. It's a very pious conversation, it's a purifying conversation. And as I'm remembering this conversation, what is happening? Rishyami cha muhurmuhu. I'm feeling thrilled at every moment. I'm feeling thrilled at each moment. Srila Prabhupada writes in the purport that when we become Krishna conscious, we enjoy life not just at a few moments, like it happens when if somebody is enjoying sensual pleasures, and the few moments when we get sensual pleasure, that's when we enjoy. There was a survey done of people in the Western world, America and Europe, of people who are reasonably healthy and reasonably wealthy, what is their emotional state in normal life? It is 5% of the time of that life they were happy, 5% of the life they were unhappy, and 90% they were bored. So, actually, life at the sensory level, if we live only for sensual pleasures, then sooner or later life becomes boring. Because sensual pleasures cannot be enjoyed all the time, they're not available all the time, so life becomes boring. So, but Prabhupada writes that when we become conscious of Krishna, when we remember Krishna, then we can enjoy life with a thrill at every moment. And he's saying, Rishyami cha mahurmuhu, as I remember this conversation, I'm feeling thrilled at each moment. So let's do this verse and the next verse, and then I'll talk a little bit about it together. The next verse is similar, 18.77 now. He says, there are many similar words also in this conversation. Yeah. Tachya samsmritya samsmritya.
Tachya samsmritya samsmritya.
Rupam atyadbhutam hareh.
Rupam atyadbhutam hareh.
Vismayo me mahan rajan.
Vismayo me mahan rajan.
Rishyami cha puna puna.
Rishyami cha puna puna.
So, tachya samsmritya samsmritya. As I am remembering that again and again, so he is, in the previous verse he said, I am remembering the conversation. Now he is saying, as I am remembering the conversation, I am remembering also the most dramatic part of the conversation. That was, the Bhagavad Gita is 17 chapters are about discussion. But one chapter is about a dramatic revelation. That revelation is the Vishwarupa. So he is saying, Rupam Atyadbhutam Hareh. I am seeing that extraordinary form, atyadbhutam, a kind of form which is never seen before. And vismayo me mahan rajan, vismayo me, I am astounded in a big way. And again, rishyami cha puna puna, again and again I am feeling thrilled. So the revelation of the Vishwarupa is dramatic, because what happens, it is one of the most extraordinary divine revelations in world history. Krishna and Arjuna are having a normal conversation and suddenly Krishna reveals. And when he reveals, okay, here. So when this form is revealed, it's such an astonishing revelation that all of space is pervaded by Krishna and all the directions. Disho na jane na labhe cha sharma. I just can't understand any direction. I can't understand what is up, down, left, right. He just gets completely disoriented. So the 11th chapter revelation is very beautifully done. Sometimes when we see something, if something is very unfamiliar, it's very difficult for us to make sense of it. So first, Krishna tells Arjuna what I am going to show you. Then Sanjaya tells Dhritarashtra what Krishna is showing. And then Arjuna tells what I am seeing. So the same form is described in three ways. So verses 5 to 8, Krishna gives the preface, this is what I am going to show you. Then verses 9 to 13, Sanjaya tells Dhritarashtra, this is what he is showing now. And from verses 14, to 30, Arjuna describes what I am seeing. So now when he describes in this verses 15 to 30, so Arjuna first sees a big form and he's amazed, he's impressed, he's thrilled. But then suddenly he starts seeing within that form something very scary, something which he's never seen before. So suppose we are watching some movie, and it's like a romantic comedy movie. And as we are watching it, suddenly it turns out to be a horror movie. Oh, some brutal kind of destruction is happening. And there is some big, dangerous, shape-changing monster is destroying a big house. And as we are watching it, that person destroying the house, and suddenly we notice it's our own house that is being destroyed. Hey, what is this? And then we try to, I don't want to see this, it's too brutal. And we try to change the channel, and the channel doesn't change only. The remote gets frozen. So for Arjuna, something like that happens to him. First he's seeing this majestic universal form and is appreciating. And then suddenly he sees this universal form is not just encompassing all of space, but it's also destroying. There is fire coming from the eyes, and there's great destruction happening all around. And then he says it's not just some remote destruction, the destruction is of all the warriors on the battlefield itself. He gets even more alarmed and he says, what is this? And that's why Arjuna asks Krishna, Akhya hime ko bhavanu grarupo, who are you? Now this is a curious question, because Arjuna has only requested Krishna, please show the universal form. And when Arjuna says, Krishna reveal the universal form, Arjuna identifies also. Pashyami Vishveshwara Vishwarupa. He says, I am seeing your universal form. But then what happens? After that, suddenly, he starts seeing something very unfamiliar. You know, if, say, we have known someone for many, many years, and they are nice, sweet, cordial, and then one day we are talking with them, and suddenly they start becoming violently angry, throwing things around, beating people, and they just become brutal. And we may ask, who are you? Who are you? What has happened? Sometimes it happens for parents that they are small, sweet children, and then the children become teenagers. And then what happened to my sweet little child? Who is this surly, uncommunicative young man who's come, young boy who's come? So when somebody completely changes the form, who is this person? So Arjuna asks, who is this? Who are you? You know, in English, in Hindi or Sanskrit, there is like a respectful second person reference. There is Tvam means you. In Hindi, you could say Tu. And Bhavan is more respectful. It's Aap. It's more respectful. So sometimes we get a phone call and we, haan, kaun hai? Tu kaun hai? Who are you? And suppose it's our boss speaking. Haan, sir, aapko kya chahiye? Sir, aap kya kar sakta hoon main? So we'll change from tu to aap. It's like more respectful second person. So initially, Arjuna uses the word tvam for referring to Krishna, tvam. But when he sees this universal form, he asks, Bhavan, who are you? Who are you? So what has happened over there? This is such an astonishing form. And then Krishna tells Arjuna that I am. Now, it's interesting when Arjuna asks this question, Krishna doesn't say I am the Vishwarupa. Because he already knows this Vishwarupa. But there is something new in the Vishwarupa that is being shown. And that is the Kala Rupa. That time, that God as the destroyer. And that's why Krishna identifies himself as Kalosmi Loka Kshekrut Pravruddho. So the Vishwarupa has been shown by Krishna earlier. He showed it to Yashoda, he showed it to Duryodhan also. And Dhritarashtra also got to see it at that time when Krishna came as a peace messenger. But the Kala Rupa has never been seen before. God as destroyer has been shown only by Krishna only to Arjuna. And here Sanjaya is reminding Dhritarashtra of that form. That Rupam Atyadbhutam Hare Hai. That form has told that all the enemies of Arjuna have already been killed. And Sanjay is saying, I remember that form. In that sense, by telling him, I remember this form, he's telling Dhritarashtra that at least now give up your attachment. Your son's destruction is destined. We can't avoid it. And Rishyami cha muhurmu. Now, why, puna puna. Now, he is feeling thrilled. Why is he feeling thrilled? Because he's a devoted person. He's devoted to Krishna and he's delighted to hear about the glory of Krishna and to see the glory of Krishna. The Bhagavad Gita, he hears the glory of Krishna. And when he sees the glory of Krishna, then he's delighted that way also. So actually, Sanjay demonstrates how we can be satisfied even when we are not successful. We can see the Bhagavad Gita as a conversation at multiple levels. It's a conversation between Krishna and Arjun, and Krishna succeeds in persuading Arjun. He changes Arjun's heart. Arjun's confusion is lost, is overcome. But Sanjaya repeats the same message to Dhritarashtra, but Dhritarashtra's heart is not transformed. Dhritarashtra still remains attached. So sometimes we may try to share Krishna bhakti with others. And sometimes people are just not interested at all. People just, nothing seems to make sense to them. So when that happens, then we may become disheartened. A devotee was telling me that he was in Russia and he was giving a class, this many years ago. He says, "You are not the body." And one person asked the question, If I am not my body, then whose body am I? So this is so convinced I am the body. And okay, if I am not my body, then am I somebody else's body? So it's so difficult for people to understand sometimes. So sometimes when we try to share Krishna bhakti and people don't understand it, we may feel disheartened. But if we understand that for us just opportunity to speak about Krishna, that itself is a blessing. By speaking about Krishna, we will be purified. And even if others are not benefited, if we understand that I am connected with Krishna by speaking, we will be purified, and that connection with Krishna will satisfy us. Generally, if we have to speak about Krishna, before that we have to prepare to speak about Krishna. And that preparation itself is absorbing. When you speak about Krishna, that is also absorbing. And if somebody hears about it and somebody benefits, from our perspective, that is a fringe benefit. Naturally, we want others to be benefited. But even if others are not benefited, just by speaking about Krishna, we are benefited. And this was Prabhupada's mood. If you see, Prabhupada is so grateful. There is this beautiful song, Markine Bhagavad Dharma. And there, Prabhupada says, Boro Krupa Koile Krishna Adhamera Prati Kilagiya Anileheta Koro Ebe Gati. He says, "My dear Lord, you have been very merciful to me that you have brought me here." Now if we look at Prabhupada's situation when he's speaking this, we say, where is the mercy? Prabhupada is a lone old man, now he's almost 70. And everything he has done for trying to share Krishna's message, it has been unsuccessful. Not, he tried to start an organization, League of Devotees, it didn't work out. He tried to start a Back to Godhead magazine, nobody was interested. He tried to work with his god brothers, and they told him to leave the ashram. He tried to himself run a business so that he could fund his spiritual master's mission, that didn't work out. He finally decided to come to America, but he got a heart attack. So, Prabhupada had very little success, and now when he's in America, he's all alone. He doesn't know anyone. He doesn't know if anyone is going to be interested in his message. And he is grateful to Krishna. "Krishna, you've been very merciful to me." Let me say, what is the mercy? "You've been very merciful to me that you have brought me here." So Prabhupada is grateful to Krishna that at least he has the opportunity to serve his spiritual master. His spiritual master wanted him to share the message of Krishna all over the world, especially in the Western world. And Prabhupada is grateful, at least now in my old age, I have the opportunity to follow that instruction. Now whether my service will be successful or not, that is in Krishna's hands. Ki lagiya ani leheta koro ebe gati. My dear Lord, now what you want me to do, you please do with me. That means a devotee is grateful even for the opportunity to serve. If we get a result from the service, that's wonderful. And we do our best to get the result from the service. But just the opportunity to serve, that connects us with Krishna. Actually, when we share Krishna bhakti with others, just by the act of sharing, we are connecting ourselves with Krishna. And if others get connected with Krishna, that is for their benefit. And if we do not have this understanding that I am speaking as a service, I am speaking to please Krishna, to please my spiritual master. Prabhupada presented preaching as a part of our sadhana. It's not that we are greatly realized souls, and based on that realization, we are speaking toward Krishna. If we may have some realization, we can share our realization. But important thing is, we do our preaching, our speaking about Krishna as a service. And if somebody doesn't have that service attitude, somebody thinks, "I am so clever, I am going to convert all these people." I was talking with a senior Vaishnava recently. He's telling, sometimes preachers take credit. I made so many people into devotees. He says, we never count We may count and claim, I brought so many people to Krishna. But we say we never count how many people didn't come to Krishna because of me.
Maybe I didn't speak properly, I didn't behave properly, I neglected people, I disrespected people.
So we never keep track of that. So actually we are not the doers. It is Krishna who is present in our hearts, Krishna is present in others' hearts. Krishna attracts people. And we simply become the instrument. So, when I started preaching, my spiritual master told me that, you know, when we are speaking about Krishna, he says, if we are proud of what you are speaking, then we may go away from Krishna. And our audience, by hearing about Krishna from us, may go towards Krishna. So the audience can make more spiritual advancement by hearing about Krishna than the speaker can make by speaking about Krishna. It all ultimately depends on whether we want to be connected with Krishna or not. So Sanjay is feeling very deeply connected with Krishna. Although externally he has not got the result, still he is enlivened. Not just enlivened, he is thrilled because he is internally connected with Krishna just by speaking the message of Krishna. So for us, sometimes in every activity that we do, whether it is our professional life, our family life, our spiritual life, sometimes when we don't get the result, we can become disheartened. But if you understand that I am doing this in a mood of service to Krishna, and then the connection with Krishna will result automatically. The test of bhakti is taste for bhakti. If you are doing bhakti yoga, if you are practicing bhakti, the test of our bhakti, doing bhakti, is not that so many people, distribute so many books, we raise so much funds, so many people come for our programs, all that is good. And we try to do that because that's also a way we serve Krishna. But when we are going to die at that time, how many classes we gave, how many books we distributed, the doorkeeper of Vaikuntha is not going to see that. Oh, you distributed so many books, therefore you can come into Vaikuntha. You're going to see how much is a heart devoted to Krishna. The test of bhakti is taste for bhakti. And that taste Sanjay is demonstrating over here. Sanjay is demonstrating, he's thrilled. So sometimes even if we don't get external success, we may get internal success. And that internal success is, we go closer to Krishna. So Sanjay is demonstrating this internal success. Let's go to the last verse now. This is 78. This is one of the most celebrated verses in the Gita. Yatra Yogeshwara Krishna. Yatra partho dhanurdharaha, partho dhanurdharaha, tatra shrir vijayo bhutir, dhruvani tirmatir mama. So, wherever there is Krishna, again the same word is Yogeshwara, which is used Saksha Yogeshwara, as used previously also. And yatra partho dhanurdhara, where there is Krishna, and Arjuna, there will be victory. So I'll talk about these 3 points in this verse and then we'll conclude. So he is first of all answering the question which Dhritarashtra had asked. What happened in the battlefield of Kurukshetra? Kima kurvata? What did they do? What happened? So he's telling what happened is that, I'll tell you all the details, but the conclusion is that actually the Pandavas were going to win. Your party is not going to win. It like sometimes, you know, say we are in different time zones and the cricket match is going on and we go to sleep and we wake up and first we see what is the result of the match. And we see the result and then, okay, what happened? Who played how? How did this team win? How does that team lose? We go and look at the details, the scores. So like that, he's telling indirectly the result. Where there is Krishna, there is going to be victory over there. So second point here he is saying is, Partha is Dhanurdharaha. Arjun had put down his bow initially, thinking, I can't fight. But now he has picked up his bow in readiness to fight. And another, now this third point is, of course, he says, wherever there is Krishna and Arjuna, there is victory. Now this may raise a question, isn't it that wherever there is Krishna, there will be victory? So why is Arjun needed over there? Krishna is the Lord of the Goddess of Fortune. So wherever he is there, the Goddess of Fortune will be there. Wherever Krishna is there, victory will be there. So why does he have to mention Arjuna over there? That where there is Krishna and where there is Arjuna, there is victory. Yes, it's true that where there is Krishna, there will be victory. But the point of the Gita is not to just declare God's position. The point of the Gita is to transform man's disposition. The point of the Gita is not that God is... The point of the Gita is to transform man's disposition. Because it's all a call for action. So the Gita was spoken to get Arjuna to change his desire, to align with Krishna's will. So that's the whole... If Krishna just wanted to speak his glories, he could have spoken in the spiritual world also. He speaks it in the material world because he wants to attract us to him. In fact, an acharya describes that just as with the same lips that Krishna plays his flute, he plays his venu. And with the venu, Geet, he calls the gopis to come to him to perform pastimes with him. And the gopis come running to Krishna. Similarly, with those same lips, which he has spoken the Venu, which is sung the Venu Geet, which is he has, he plays the flute, with the same lips he speaks the Bhagavad Gita. So the song of the flute is sung so that he can attract the pure devotees. The song of the Bhagavad Gita is spoken by those same lips to attract all of us conditioned souls. And he attracts all of us so that we can also come to him. So that we can join with him in his wonderful pastimes. Most people, they come to God and they ask God, I want to do this, I want to do this, I want to do this. And you help me in this. Now Krishna is performing pastimes in the spiritual world and he's inviting pastimes there. However, when some people, they come to God and they pray to God, their idea is, I want to perform pastimes here. You come and help me in my pastimes. You help me fulfill my desires, execute my plans. So, the Bhagavad Gita is not talking about making God do man's will. The Bhagavad Gita is talking about man doing God's will. And that is conveyed by including Arjuna over there. Arjuna has agreed to do Krishna's will. Prabhupada, in one lecture, says, what is Krishna consciousness? This can be understood in many different ways. Prabhupada could have said that Krishna consciousness means that, oh, chant Hare Krishna constantly. Krishna consciousness, we absorb in Krishna's pastimes. I was a few months ago, a couple of months ago, I was talking with his owner, Giriraj Maharaj. And Maharaj is writing a book on about the Juhu project, how the whole temple manifests, how Prabhupada fought for it. So he said he's now meditating on Prabhupada and getting deeper appreciation of Prabhupada. More and more. So he said that he was talking with Shrutakirti Prabhu and somebody asked Shrutakirti Prabhu, what was the quality of Srila Prabhupada that attracted you the most? And he said, Shrutakirti Prabhu, the answer surprised me very much. He said, when he first said it. So I thought it's very true. He said, I had not met any person as practical as Srila Prabhupada. Now, practical means, is practicality a very great quality? No, but practicality means whatever was required for the service of Krishna, Prabhupada did that. And that's how he was practical. So Prabhupada's purpose was clear, I have to serve Krishna and whatever is required for that, he will do that. So Prabhupada gives a very... So Prabhupada says, what is Krishna consciousness? So if you come in front of the temple, come in the temple and stand in front of the deities, and if you feel Krishna is asking us, what are you doing for me? If we feel a sense of a personal relationship with Krishna and we feel a personal commitment to Krishna, what are you doing for me? Then we are Krishna conscious. Most people come to the temple and they ask Krishna, what are you doing for me? I prayed for this, this happened, I got this problem, I haven't solved this problem, what are you doing for me? But pure devotion inverts this normal dynamic. Is what am I doing for Krishna? And that is the mood. Prabhupada says when Arjun hears, Krishna says that I have already killed. So Prabhupada says Arjun doesn't tell Krishna, Krishna, by your plan already they are killed, then you also execute your plan. He says, no. He says, I take up the plan. So, yatra partho dhanurtharaha. So that Arjuna's will is transformed. That is indicated by Arjuna picking up his bow in readiness to fight. So for us, we all have various plans. And sometimes when our plans don't seem to be working, we get frustrated. We feel resentful. We feel hopeless. We feel powerless. But we have to understand that just because our plan is not working, just because things are going wrong in our life, doesn't mean that things are wrong. There is our plan and then there is a higher plan. So, if we look at how our plan is not working, we will feel frustrated. But if we shift our vision to Krishna, and Krishna is always in control, and Krishna always has a plan, and Krishna's plan is always working, always works. So, when we raise our vision to Krishna's plan, and we understand, I have a place in Krishna's plan. I have to do my service. Let me do my service right now. So rather than thinking, why is this not happening? Why is this happening this way? We can ask, what is my service in this situation? How can I serve in this situation? And in every situation, we always have an opportunity to serve. And that can help us to be grateful. That can help us to be grateful. So although Sanjay's speech has not been successful in terms of transforming Dhritarashtra's heart, but because he's grateful for the opportunity to hear about Krishna, by Vyasa's mercy, so he's joyful. And although Arjun has to fight this terrible war, but still he is determined. Because now he's not thinking in terms of my plan. I have Krishna, there is Krishna's plan, I am simply a servant in Krishna's plan. So let me do my best in a mood of service. And thus, as Arjuna became enlivened, raising his bow in readiness to fight. So Arjun's bow can be said to represent our determination, our enthusiasm, our energy. Sometimes life may put us in such perplexities and adversities that we lose heart. But if we shift our vision from our plan that is not working to Krishna's plan that is always working, and then we try to serve Krishna, we'll find that our morale will be restored, that our determination will come back. And just as Arjun picked his bow in readiness to fight, we will also become energetically ready to serve Krishna. Such was Prabhupada's mood when he came on alone to America. Krishna, whatever you want, let me do it. Nachao, nachao, Prabhu, nachao se mate, kashthera putali jatha, nachao se mate. My dear Lord, as you want to make me dance, make me dance, make me dance, O Lord, make me dance. So that mood of surrendered service was what gave Srila Prabhupada extraordinary empowerment to overcome all obstacles and bless all of us, enrich all of us with the supreme treasure of Krishna Bhakti. And that empowerment can come to us, not to that degree, but to whatever degree we need to overcome whatever obstacles come in our way and march forward according to Krishna's plan. And even if we don't understand the specifics of Krishna's plan, faith means that we take one step. Even if the full road is not clear, if the full road is not clear, I take one step, one step, one step, one step, and eventually the road will become clear and Krishna's plan will become manifest to us. So I'll summarize. I spoke today on the theme of how Sanjay appreciates the Bhagavad Gita. So in 18.74, the first verse I talked about how Sanjay appreciates that he's heard an extraordinary conversation between extraordinary souls. Krishna is Mahatma and Arjuna has become Ahatma because of being devoted to the Mahatma. So we need to appreciate the value of what we are getting before we can benefit from it. And then 18.75 I talked about how Sanjay was the incidental beneficiary of Vyasa's mercy. But he is grateful not only for the gift that he has been given, but also by the grace of whom he got that gift. And he cherished, because he values what he's getting, then it has a valuable effect on him. And what is that effect? He remembers again and again the conversation and the revelation within that conversation. The words of Krishna and the form of Krishna. And both of these make him thrilled. So although at an external level, the result doesn't come for him, Dhritarashtra's heart is not transformed. But his own heart is transformed, it becomes enlivened. So sometimes we may not get the external result of our service, But the internal result of becoming connected with Krishna is always there. And the test of service is taste for service. The test of devotion is taste for devotion. And lastly, we discussed about how the Bhagavad Gita is spoken to transform man's disposition. And that transformation happens to Arjun, and he surrenders, raising his bow in diligence for Krishna. So there is dependence for Krishna, that's one way of devotion. There is diligence for Krishna, another way of devotion. So Arjun becomes diligent in his devotion to Krishna. And similarly, we can become diligent. Although we may sometimes feel things going wrong in our life, we feel resentful of them. But if we give up our attachment to our plans and become open to Krishna's plan, then we can feel grateful that we have just the opportunity to serve Krishna. Prabhupada was grateful, even though there would be no result tangibly of his service, he was grateful that he just had the opportunity to serve. And he was ready to serve in whatever way Krishna wanted. And Krishna empowered him extraordinarily. Just as Krishna empowered Arjun to overcome extraordinary opponents, just as Krishna empowered Prabhupada to overcome extraordinary obstacles, similarly, Krishna can empower us to overcome whatever obstacles we have. If we just shift our vision from our plan to his plan, we try to become conscious of Krishna, then he will guide us one step at a time through whatever difficulties we are facing towards the ultimate spiritual prosperity of eternal ecstatic devotion for him. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. Any questions or comments? How much time do we have? You can let me know.
10 more minutes.
Okay, thank you.
Regarding transformation point, so during Bhagavad Gita, relationship of Arjuna to Krishna changes from friend to disciple.
Correct.
So is the Gita's message to people like us, disciple is the right way of going and doing the devotional service rather than a friendship?
Means, are you saying that while practicing bhakti, we should have the mode of a disciple rather than of a friend?
Yeah.
With whom? With Krishna or with our spiritual master? Or whom? With both?
Both.
Okay. Yeah, there is one of my friends is from the Sri Vaishnava tradition, and he said that you Hare Krishnas have got everything wrong. He said, when you refer to Krishna, you don't use any honorific. You don't use Shri, you don't use Bhagawan, you just say Krishna. And for Radha, you have double honorific. You have Srimati and Rani. Just why don't you respect Krishna? So I said that Prabhupada, actually, what to speak of using an honorific, Prabhupada coined a special term for Krishna. What is that?
Supreme.
The Supreme Personality of Godhead. And it's a wisdom-packed term. So Prabhupada definitely has great respect for Krishna. And he wants us to have that respect. That's why he uses that term also. But at the same time, Prabhupada taught us that Krishna is not a remote, inaccessible God. We need adequate reverence in approaching to him. But still, to be with Prabhupada was to feel like Krishna was a person who was with us. Hayagriva Prabhu writes in one of his biography that one day Prabhupada just came and told him, you start back to Godhead magazine now. He told Prabhupada, till now, I never done anything except the magazine except read it. How do I produce a magazine? And Prabhupada told him that you pray to Krishna, Krishna will guide you. So he said, to be with Krishna was to feel, to be with Prabhupada was to feel that Krishna was a real person who will help us if we try to serve him. So Prabhupada wanted us to have a personal relationship with Krishna. Not in a sahajiyaic sense that we imagine entering into Krishna's confidential pastimes. But in a real sense, where we understand Krishna is God, we are his servants, and Krishna cares for us and we care for him by trying to serve him. So in that sense, we do have to have that mood of devotion and submission, which is appropriate for a disciple. But at the same time, we also have a mood of a personal relationship. So for the purpose of hearing the Bhagavad Gita, Arjun did ask Krishna the questions, and shishyasteham, he took the mood of a servant. But immediately after that, what was required for the service, he did that. And when he was fighting throughout the Bhagavad Gita, throughout the Mahabharata war, and thereafter Krishna and Arjuna are friends. So the point is that when we need to be instructed, at that time we need to have the necessary submission. But when we have to do a particular service, then we have to do what it takes for the service. So when Prabhupada was in America, at that time he often relied on his disciples about where he should go for preaching. He was in New York, and it was not that Prabhupada had some like omniscience by which he knew that now I should go to San Francisco. And San Francisco, there is this big counterculture movement going on and people will be very receptive. No, his own disciples, they said, Swami, there are a lot of receptive people over there. Please come over there. And Prabhupada went over there. So the point is that when Prabhupada was giving philosophical instructions, Prabhupada was the acharya, and the disciples were completely ignorant. But with respect to practically doing things, Prabhupada took inputs from his disciples. So should he go here or should he go there? Sometimes the devotee said that if we dress in dhoti kurta, we will be able to connect with far lesser people. Can we wear shirt pant? Prabhupada said yes. Don't dress like hippies. Dress respectably. So Prabhupada, with respect to practical service, if Prabhupada knew that a disciple knew something more, then Prabhupada took that input. So our mood is primarily of service. So while receiving instructions, we have to have the mood of submission. But if you're for doing a particular service and another mode of relationship is required, then we adopt that mood of relationship. Throughout it all, the mood is the mood of service. Okay? Thank you. Yes.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji. So in Gita, Arjun surrenders to Krishna and he says, I'm ready to follow your will. But still we know like when he was fighting with Bhishma Pitama, he wasn't fighting with full effort and Krishna had to intervene that why are you not trying to kill him? So how do we understand, like once he said that I'm ready to follow your will, and I have understood all that you told me, yet when he was fighting with Bhishma.
Okay, I got a question, yeah. So when Krishna and Arjuna said to Krishna that I'm going to do your will, but yet Arjuna didn't fight wholeheartedly with Bhishma. It is not that our consciousness stays completely aloof of whatever situation we are facing in life. We are conscious beings. We may have a fixed intention, but based on the kind of situation that we are facing in our life, how to execute that intention, our emotions and our particular concerns will affect that. Once Srila Prabhupada was in India, and one reporter, it was 1976 or 77, a reporter asked Prabhupada that many movements have been started by some spiritual leaders, but after that leader passes away, after the leader departs, the movement collapses. So, do you think the same thing will happen to your movement, Prabhupada? And Prabhupada asked, instead of answering the question, Prabhupada said, why are you discouraging me? Swamiji, I'm not discouraging you. I'm only asking you a question. Prabhupada said, but your question is a discouraging question. Now, can Prabhupada be discouraged? Even when Prabhupada was all alone, he was all alone going to America, walking along on the streets with nobody interested. Still, Prabhupada was determined. So, that means Prabhupada's determination was above his emotion. Prabhupada's intention was above his emotion. In a sense, determination means to keep our intention above our emotion. Emotions will come and go, but the intention stays above our emotion, that is determination. But that doesn't mean, just because you have determination, doesn't mean we'll have no emotion. Emotions are natural. So there are so many letters of Prabhupada, when he gets a good preaching report, he says, your report is so encouraging to me. And if some disciple has some problems, Prabhupada says, I'm feeling forlorn. Prabhupada says, so there are emotions. It's not that as devotees, we are not meant to have emotions. It is just that our emotion doesn't stop our service to Krishna. So it's just natural when Arjun had to fight against Bhishma. Bhishma was his grandfather, almost like his father, because Pandu died early. And Bhishma had cared for him, trained him. So when he has to fight against Bhishma, it's very difficult for him. Now Arjun tells Krishna, how can I fight against Bhishma? He says, when I was a small child, I would play in the forest, play in the play outside and come back, and then I would climb on the lap of Bhishma, and then I would dirty his dhoti, dirty his clothes, and then I would play with his beard, and I would say, father, father, and Bhishma would fondle my hair, and then he would say, child, I am not your father, I am the father of your father. So Arjuna has such tender memories with Bhishma. So for him to fight against Bhishma is not easy. So to spiritualize ourselves doesn't mean to dehumanize ourselves. They're natural human emotions. It's just that we don't let the human emotions interfere with our spiritual intention. So at that time his reluctance was natural. But when Krishna took up the bow, took up the wheel and was about to attack Bhishma, Arjun did not say, oh, I can't do this, you do this. Immediately Arjun's devotion got into picture. He says, oh, Krishna has given his word that I am not going to raise weapons. If Krishna raises weapons, then Krishna will be defamed. I cannot afford that. And Arjun immediately jumped off his chariot and ran towards Krishna, yelling to him, stop, stop, stop. Krishna was not ready to listen. So Arjun literally launched himself, leapt and caught Krishna by the foot. And although he caught Krishna's thighs, Krishna was so concerned for Arjun that Krishna was still marching on. And he was dragging Arjun with his foot. And then finally, Arjun actually raised his foot and banged the foot on the ground. And his powerful Kshatriya foot, so he created a hole in the ground. And his foot got caught in the hole. And then he held on to Krishna, and Krishna stopped at that time. And then he yelled to Krishna, he called out to Krishna, I will fight wholeheartedly. Please, you don't break your vow. So, at that time, then Krishna calmed down. And then they came back. And next day, Arjun did fight. So, there is normal human emotion and there is spiritual intention. So, we can't wish away the human emotion. So, when the human emotion, the spiritual intention, where the spiritual devotion was there, at that time, when it was a point of choosing between the two, he did choose a spiritual devotion and he did fight. So it's just a normal human emotion that was there at that time. Okay, thank you. Last question, or should we stop here? Okay, we can talk one to one. Parimam, any comments?
Very good.
Okay, thank you very much. Srimad Bhagavad Gita ki, Srila Prabhupada ki, Gaur Bhakta Vrinda ki, Gaur Premanande.
Thank you so much, Prabhuji. Can you all chant three times Hari Bol to thank Chaitanya Charan Prabhu?
Hari Bol! Hari Bol! Hari Bol!
Chaitanya Charan Prabhu is also a prolific writer. He has written more than 20 books, and fortunately today we have few.